cero que vamos a hacer para ganar. En aguas más santas, eso es agua. Excellency, Ambassador of the Laos and our friends. Anyway, I'm not a Buddha, so I could not foresee what I'm going to, who the audience will be here. And I also have to apologize first because I thought this would be a good opportunity for people to have a real discussion. So that's why I bring up one of the very controversial Buddhist texts. But, and I'm not very good at the Dharma in a certain way, not like Paramparatana, you know, can recite it without any, you know, text or book. So I cannot change any subject. If the topic was not suitable for you and whatever the reason is, please forgive. Today, actually, I'd like to address one of the very controversial sutta called Kalama Sutta. And why I like to bring this about is, even though actually I was ordained in Sri Lanka like 30 years ago, and I've been studying Pali and Sanskrit and so forth, even though I'm a Chinese origin. But I almost like never heard this sutta before. However, when I just, before I came to America, I lived in England. When I was in England, this is almost like, almost people who are studying Buddhism really know this sutta. And that's certainly, and people always like to discuss this sutta with me. And people sometimes, to my understanding, presenting the different pictures regarding the sutta. So I thought that might be a good time that people have a much better discussion, just I like to introduce the sutta a little bit in case people do not know. And also, I guess, certainly I'd like to present a certain idea on what this sutta is about. We know that Buddha has been having his missionary work after his enlightenment for 45 years. It's very different from other religions. In other words, he had given so many texts, so many teachings for 45 years. If people who are understanding religious in a certain way, imagine if for 45 years and having more than 10,000 students and believe that very highly attend our heart in those days, I mean, the Buddha definitely gave a lot of wonderful teaching. And this is one of that, which is a little controversial, it's interesting, right? Now, just allow me just begin, actually, basically the sutta start with when the Buddha living in a place that they call the towns the Kalamas. And then usually they call them as a Kesa Buddha. Basically means their hair is, they make a knot at the hair. They would not let the hair be loosely, you know. And the problem is that because that place is very close to the forest. And a lot of these people, you know, in Indian tradition, that person, highly attacked person, we go to the forest and go inside to have like 6 years, 5 years, almost like doing his recluse life. However, when the people finish their recluse life 5 or 6 years at the camp, and then these people have this good opportunity to meet a lot of different religious people, different holding different ideas, and what having a high end in the spirituality. So that's why the problem is that then these people come out, they always tell them, I found the truth. And then my truth is the only one. And of course, they've been here by different teachers before. And they would like to ask, what about the teachers I learned? And they say, no, they were wrong. Mine is the only correct. And I'm sure, as I'm in a different case, because I was actually grew up, even as a Chinese, we do have a kind of folk religious belief overall, but not my father and not my mother. On the contrary, actually, my parents against me to study any religion. To my parents thinking, having religion is somehow almost like living poison. I'm sorry to say that. When this is how I grew up in, as a young kid. So that's why when I read this text, I can really speak to my mind too. That when I was young, that's how we learned that everyone say they are right, then who is correct? You know, and how we can do, what can we can do. I think this is now we like to see how the Buddha given us advice. All right, so according to the text, according to the text, and these people, when they come out, they will tell them, they will explain the doctrine, they will, you know, kind of like explain, and even you glorify his teaching and so forth. Now, then after that, these people who have this good opportunity, almost like in America. So in some way, you know, like the way that I grow in the country, usually we only have just able just within one tradition. But in America, you meet so many different traditions before. And then, you know, you certainly must come up in a certain way that to understand what the teaching is about. The same thing, then they have perplexity, they're confused. Now, who is correct, who is right? And then now, at that time, the Buddha came to that town, and people informed them, they came to the town, so that's why they went to see the Buddha. They went to see the Buddha, but according to the Buddhist text, it's very clear. These people came as a group, a big group, the Guru with the Buddha, just to understand because they believe Buddha is a fully enlightened one. They must give a better answer. So, but then, according, you know, there's an old way to translate, because this early Buddhist text, you could see the style is all by oral transmission. So the style is very clear. He said that the person, actually some people, when they met the Buddha, they knee before the Buddha and sit by the side. Some just stand there. Some just stand far away. Some with the hand just like, you know, they put the hand in different way. And you know, those tradition in those days, 2,500 years ago, it just want to show some people come here with respect to the Buddha, some they don't. Some they just fight. Some just say, okay, I want to see who is that person is about and what he's going to say. Now, and then it happens that suddenly, and then they ask a question, just like I mentioned, that so many teachers say different things. How we know who is correct? Because everyone say they are the best. They are the correct one. Now, that's how the Buddha replied. Just allow me to read it, even though I don't like reading it usually. Say, it is proper for you to be perplexed. O Kalamas, it is fitting for you to be in doubt. Doubt has arisen in you about the perplexing matter. Come, Kalamas, do not go by now. There's 10 things that do not go by. It's, as I say, it's a little controversial in certain sense. First, do not go by the oral tradition. Second, do not go by the lineage of teaching. Third, do not go by the hearsay. Fourth, do not go by collection of scriptures. Fifth, do not go by the logical reasoning. Sixth, do not go by inferential reasoning. Seven, do not go by reflection of reasons. Eight, do not go by the acceptance of the real after pondering it. Number nine, do not go by the seeming incompetence of the speaker. Number 10, just like me, middle incompetence. Then number 10, do not go by because you think, oh, the aesthetic is our teacher. This is certainly is very common, right? So here the Buddha say that this might not be one of the ways you should judge. I mean, I'm sure lots of religion, including even Buddhism sometimes, as I say, it can relate to me in a certain sense because I wasn't brought as a Buddhist kind. Buddhist family, and maybe more like materialistic family. Of course, now I'm a monk now for 30 years. Certainly, I have my favor in Buddhism. But you know, and those are the things I could definitely agree 100% to me. And the Buddha actually saying that, you know, those are the things. It's not the means for you to think that, because first, I mean, I might have put a draft later. I don't. If you look at this, if I didn't. So all these, some are related to authority. You know, they say, oh, because that is a teaching from my teacher. Or because that's a teaching from the lineage. You know, lineage, they have a lineage. Or that's because it's, you know, from the long past, it's been passed down such a way, you have no need to change that. So that is about authority. And some are purely reasoning nowadays. We think about it. We think that, you know, is it true, is it right? You know, nowadays we are living in a scientific world. Everything is about proved with the science here. I mean, at least that's why I advocate it. So, and this kind of reasoning, you might have a very, even some argue that, no, you can reason with that. You could have a logic to think about it. So those are the means of judging. And actually, I saw some on a paper talking that somehow they address the same Kalama Sutta, but they put it in a different way, saying that the Buddha agreed that by logic, you know, by reference, by logical understanding, you could prove that that's a Dhamma is correct. Now, this sutta say that, the Buddha say that, now these 10 kind of things, you should not 100% rely on it. Now, however, this is what comes next is interesting. He say, these things are unwholesome. Now, but he say, but when you know for yourself, these things are unwholesome, these things are blamable, these things are censured by the wise, these things if undertaken and practice lead to harm and suffering, then you should abandon them. Okay. By rejecting a lot of even Indian culture, even including a certain culture, or even including what we learn from a Buddhist text sometimes. Here, the Buddha said, do not go by, of course, he's not saying that this is completely nonsense, but just you don't have to completely rely on that. But you have to, in a way, that if the thing you know is not working, if the thing is blamable, if that condition is not good, then you should know that you should abandon it. Okay. So here is very important in the next sentence is the Buddha must come to agreement with this group of people. And this is also with me too. So firstly, I remember once I was talking by this example when I was talking with certain other religions. When he tell me that how important their religion is about, and I told them that my understanding in Buddhism is very important to address ethical issue about the hatred, the craving, and also the delusion, right? And they say, what are the Mahayanas here talking about? We are religious people. The religious people only talk the faith, you know, worship and belief. I say, well, I mean, that's fine. But my understanding is, as a Buddhist, I don't mean everybody have to follow that path, but as a Buddhist, we must certainly first come to a common agreement there. What is a common agreement? I just borrow this from Buddha, like his Kalama Sutta. So that's why Buddha come the next sentence asking. So even though we might reject everything there, but how we should have a common agreement? What is that? That do you agree that when the person had to greet hatred and delusion, that will lead your life or lead the society back? Do you agree with that or not? You know, somehow that's how the whole conversation. And then he also say that, you know, just like, you know, when a person killing, when a person taking what is not taken, like running from attacks, you know, stealing, cheating, and having this sexuality problem, and all sort of things, or sexual misconduct, so, and tell lies. I mean, do you agree with that? Of course, I'm sure this is commonly, universally disagree, right? That means person should not commit this, because committing this is not good for oneself, and it's not good for society. Now, that the common ground, they have the agreement, and then that the Buddha, in a different way, put it other way, saying that, so, okay, what about if these people absent of this problem that we just mentioned, absent of the greed, absent of the hatred, and absent of the delusion, do you think they were good for you and good for the society, good for the people? And these Kalamas, as I said, we must understand their background. They have listened to many already. And now, then they agree with the Buddha, saying that yes, because if the person do not have this, certainly it will be good for that person itself and good for the society. So only come to that, then the Buddha, according to the text, then the Buddha say, so again he was saying that, so for this reason, Kalamas, that we said, do not go upon all these 10. That is not the way that, you know what, nowadays we have war, we have a lot of violence, we have a lot of discriminations, we have a lot of unfair treatment in the society, you within ourselves and so forth. Or they have their quotation saying that, because this is how I believe, I could do it, right? I don't need to mention what religion, I don't need to mention what kind of action they're doing, but I'm sure you know somehow. You cannot argue with them because your text is wrong, right? But if this is the common ground we should come upon, and I think we should follow what the Buddha advised, at least when the people get confused. And they have this kind of only strong head believing that because they have the text, because they have the what religion they have, because they have so-called a pass off on the law, and they could abuse people. They could really manipulate that and, you know, to harm the others. And then that's what one of the wonderful wisdom that shown by the Buddha. So, and he said, no, you don't. Because we people can come to common sense. Who like to be killed? No one like to be killed. Then why you want to kill others? Who like to, the thing to be stolen? Nobody like the thing to be stolen. But why you want to steal the thing from the others? Right? The same thing. Who like to, their wife, you know, also for having the sexual problem with other persons. Nobody like this. Well, then why you want to come to those things? And so forth. So that's what the morality, the ethic is. First thing, it's not about, it's not the time that we should discuss, I'm the best, I'm the right, because so, 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 and so. It's because everybody knows this is wrong. We come to agree with that, and then we can come to a better solution. Yes, this is the next, the better solution. Now, when we come to agree that the ethic, the morality, and this greed, hatred, delusion can be one of the big problem in the whole world now, and the solution is how we can make it better. So, one of the ways, for in the general sense. So then, that's what he say. That the next, I like to read a little bit. He say, then Calamus, that noble disciple, devoid of covetousness, devoid of ill will, confused, clearly comprehending, ever mindful, dress pervading one quarter with the mind, imbued with the loving kindness, likewise the second quarter, the third and the fourth, the above, below, across and everywhere, and to all as himself, he dressed pervading the entire world with the mind imbued with loving kindness, was absorbed, measureless, without hostility, and without ill will. Now, I know it is a long sentence, but generally that's what the Buddha is saying. Now, if person has this love mind, I'm sure every religious talk can talk. Now, I like to remind people also, I always have the impression of Buddhism to talk about love. And at least that's one of the reasons my parents will prohibit me to go to learn at least in Buddhism. I don't understand why, okay? Because it's not fair to my parents. But suddenly, I'm just saying about myself, my experiences. The way that I thought about Buddhism is always like, oh, you are a Buddhist, and then as a Chinese tradition, you chant Amitabha, 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 and then when you die, Amitabha will take you to the paradise, the way called the Western paradise, Pure Land. And this is my impression of Buddhist. And or either just go to the temple and you see the people worshiping, you know, praying in front of a statue. That's it. And then I was a Christian before I became a Buddhist. Then I went to the Christian, and it's always telling you how important love is and so forth. And this is I thought, okay. And the Buddhists always ask you to give up everything. You know, you have to live the life almost like a, I don't know what it is, monk, but you know, like somebody is really very remote. That's the reason why even sometimes when I meet some Chinese, they ask you, do you breathe? And they say, why would they ask me this? They thought, still they have a mystical image, thinking the monk, they don't eat. They just breathe and then they sustain the physical. You know, it's true. If you have a time to go to China, especially when you go to a remote area, they were very surprised to see the monk. Even they ask, why the monk wear gloves? You know? They have so many kind of different image about the monk. But hardly people thinking the monk must have one of the best quality, that is the love, the kindness, the loving mind, or what usually we call loving kindness. But I like to translate the love. So that really love ourselves and love everyone. So, but here, the Buddha said very clearly, we, you know, if that when we understand in the common ground that this kind of ethical is very important, and we certainly still need to build up something nice within. The something nice is that you must have this love, the love for yourself. Now, one of the sentences I really love it. I remember once I was in China, just a little story. I don't want to make you fall asleep. So, actually, when I went to China, they were kind of like, I didn't expect, but it became like a business. Almost like, oh, you're the mom, come from America, big mom, something like that. I'm not a big mom, I'm really small. But and then kind of and then found this kind of like business. So and I'm very straightforward. In other words, I'm not like Buddha, can speak nicely. I say very clearly, no, I don't like to be involved here. But of course I thought it's good enough, but to that person it's not good enough. So he was very disappointed. And then I told him, do you mind that now I need to leave? Could you send me to the airport? We were driving almost 1.5 hours. Almost no speaking. Because it's almost we are in a situation of like embarrassment, because he thought he could invite me over there for that business, but I think I refused to do business with him and so forth. Okay. But I think it's not very nice. We should break the ice. And I need to thank some people who are very skillful. And then one of his assistants, very skillful. And he said, and he turned his head and asked me, oh, master, in Chinese, in two respect ways, say, master, I heard about the Diamond Sutra. According to the Diamond Sutra, blah, 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 say this and that. And I told him, I think to explain the Diamond Sutra, maybe a little too, we don't have much time. Why don't I tell you one word I love the most? Oh yes, why not? Then I told him that one of the words actually helped me tremendously in my life is that the Buddha said, when you look around and you see everyone, they want the best of their life, right? Everyone, they want the best of their life. So the Buddha said, the same, if those people who love themselves, they would want that they don't want to be harmed by them, because they also want the best of their life. I just told him that. And suddenly everybody laughing, everybody smiling, and our problem solved. In other words, I clearly tell them I don't want to do this. It's because I have my position, right? And how we break the ice, I just tell them what the Buddha say. You want your best. I'm not here to say you whatever you are, but it's just not what I'm doing, right? So I respect what you like, because everybody loves their job and love their work to be the best. And I also too want the best of myself. And then we hug each other and left happily. And of course, we still keep in contact. So even when it came to my day, still come to see me. So that is it. One of the things that the Buddha said, even this kind of love yourself, love everyone, that even you could even can be sending off to everybody. I mean, we might just think about myself, maybe just my relative or friend. But sometimes you could just think about, like here, if thinking about everyone, everyone is different, everyone has different opinions. So if you send that kind of mind to them, wish them to be happy, to be well all the time, then our conflict itself is solved. I don't know, I mean, I'm sure a lot of you are very talented, much more, tackle the problem much more better than me. I can only speak for myself when I was looking at the big monastery when I was in New York. You never know these all kind of organizations. So difficult to tackle, I can tell you almost that. I always want to hang myself, even being a monk. Okay. But what saved me? Because that is hatred, I feel, why these people are like that, But, then I learned this from Satan that I should learn to myself, may I be free from suffering, may I be happy, because I deserve the happy. And after that, I feel a little better. And I also wish that these people, I don't like them, they don't follow what my instruction. They always give me troubles, but I need to change my mind that you'll be happy. Okay, fine. Then you'll be happy. Then you'll be happy. Good luck. And I just force it. Somehow I make it. And I feel nice. And at least I don't need a hand. Otherwise, you don't see me here anymore. Okay. Myself. Now, that's the first thing. It's about the love. And so much powerful. And the second, and then the Buddha saying, and even you also can develop the compassion. Sometimes we need compassion. The compassion, it's like, when you see people suffer, you are happy, fine, but you must have a little compassion. Thinking, it doesn't sound nice. You don't want to show, hey, do you want to drink this? Really nice. It might be, you are stirring his emotion, right? Rather, you say, how are you? Are you doing okay? What can I help you, right? Maybe you have a very merry mood, but you could show your compassion to a certain person, right? That makes everything goes better. That's the second. And the third one, and then he say, the same thing, you could even have the, what we call altruistic joy. And this is also very important. It's maybe sometimes easier to have love yourself, love the other, and it's easier to have compassion to yourself and to compassion to other. However, sometimes it's very hard when you see the other people do better than you. Success. You start to feel, why he, why not me, right? Somebody win the lottery, why he, why not me? But this is called altruistic joy. You're just happy for them. What's the harm? I always tell people, and this is my I have to say, when I was a mom earlier time, I was really bitter mom. I always think the people are not doing better than me. I always think I'm better. You know, this is nature that we have this. But later I learned, because even though I think I'm good, you know, nobody thinks I'm not good. I think I'm good anyway, I was good. However, the thing it is, people could see it actually. They know. You're good or not. They know. I always say actually people are the eyes. Our eyes looking in front. We cannot look inside usually. You don't know, and people know it. Yeah. So in other words, usually I also faced one problem. There was a time I told people I got a scholarship, I could go to England now. And what was my result? I was shocked. Those my friend, he told me, I thought you're a good man. Actually you're a greedy man. You want to go to England. And I was really like, really? That's what I mean, I need to thank him in this way now. After that I started to reflect. Yes, maybe I'm greedy. But as a person, why can't I just happy for me? That because I got a scholarship, at least, you know, as a mom, we don't have that kind of financial and to go to study with, you know, in England. So, and then this is what I mean. It's like, if that time, if the person, my good friend, told me, oh, I'm so happy for you, even though I hope you might be even do more meditation than you do to academic or study, but at least, you know, with the altruistic joy, that what, because I feel happy. Right. So that's just one thing I think, and this is how later on I learned, after when I changed my mind, whenever people have success, I'm just happy for them. I have to say, it doesn't mean that I don't have jealous, but I know this is bad for me, bad for that person. When they have success, they have bigger temple, they have much more money, wonderful, thank you for nice. And I have few friends in the past, we have a little, not so nice, I have to say, a little story. And one day I met him in America, so in a Berlin big conference, and suddenly after 10 years, 15 years, we never met. So we met, we were happy. And I said, why are you here? I'm looking for the job, actually, I'm interviewing. So I said, good, I really hope you will get a job, you deserve that. And since then, we become one of the best friends. What if, at that time, I think, oh, really, you look for the job? Okay, yeah, you know, people can read you, I'm jealous. Yeah, not happy to them. No, I really sincerely say, should get a job, you know, and so forth. And then now we really become a really good friend. It's just that moment. Imagine we living together 5 years ago. We never really talked that much. And after 15 years we met, and just I just show simple attitude. I mean, I'm not pretending. I really wish that person get a job. And that changed our relationship. Even now we are so good friends. So. Now that's what I think that the Buddha was saying. You know, we definitely must have this altruistic joy towards other person also. When they are successful, you should be happy for them. And I think this is very important. This is how we can grow our society too, right? Otherwise, you try all the means, all the bad way to stop the person, rather than helping the person grow better and better. And in return, you will be even better for them. Now the last one is for the equanimity. And Buddha said, equanimity mind is a very different farm, the love mind, a little different farm, the compassion mind, and a little different farm is what we call altruistic joy's mind. However, this kind of mind, just suddenly your mind just normalize, settle down, become very calm. Why we need that kind of mind? Because sometimes we need this kind of mind to understand clearly, right? You know, and then understand the person clearly, whatever is doing clearly. And this kind of mind also gives you wonderful kind of feeling that you have a very calm and joy. And also, in Buddhism, believe that the wisdom will come from the Buddha. Okay, after the Buddha said this, and then, this disciple, after when he heard this, and then the Buddha said, you know, and it's also answered one of my questions. Of course, now I don't have those questions. He said, once people are like that, they will full assurance or solaces will be developed. What are they? You know, there are some people who do not believe in this next life. They will reborn. Yeah, maybe in a certain culture, yes, they will believe that. In a certain, they don't. But the Buddha said, if you have this kind of quality, good mind, a positive mind with you, when the person dies, even though there will no such thing for the next life, even if there's no such thing for next life, but he can live now. You know, he said, I will live happily, free of enmity, and ill will. No suffering. And if the person is that there's a next life, then of course, then he would not be born in a bad place. And if the person, suppose that a person that, that when the person that, something that bad thing comes to them, because he's my age, elderly, from those problems, so he would be also in heaven. And the last one is me, when they have the mind, and he could live happily, and people respect. In other words, mean you only get, you don't lose. This is really one of the, I think is really, that's one of the teachings. It's not only the sutta, but I just pick up the sutta. Saying that, basically mean, if you have this kind of four quality of mind, by having a common recognition of that, the greed, the hatred, and delusion is not conducive goodness, and then you would have this uncorrupt mind and pure. So, and he will warm all this in right here. So, okay. Of course, the text, I will say that in ends, the text say that when these people want to hear that, they never heard this before. Otherwise, usually teacher will tell you, mind is the best, don't listen to other. Mind is the best, don't listen to other. But the result is after the Buddha approached them in, you could say, a skillful way for these people when having a confused mind, what to select, and they know what they should do. And then they say, and then they say, yeah, so that's why, and he placed the Buddha, it's, how to say, so it's like to reveal what was hidden or to point out the way to hold one gone astray or to hold a lamp in the darkness so that those who have eyes might see the forms. That's how I conclude the text, and I don't like to hold much anyway. I know this, as I say, a little controversial. I like to conclude a little bit. It's a little controversial in terms of because of the 10 thing. You don't have to rely on the text. You don't have to rely on this is my teacher, not as a lineage, not because of logical so it says so, because of a lot of proof, the proof so, and so forth. But back to that, we all, as a human, must have the common sense. We know what is greed that can make us. What is no greed can make us, right? We have a common sense what is hatred can make us and without hatred can make us. We know the common sense that what is illusion can make us and without illusion can make us. And then we can give the peace, love, mind, altruistic joy, compassion, and a very calming, fundamental mind. Then we live happily now. And I'm sure that, and we also, I have a lot of soul, I don't want to say that, but we also, not that, I'm sure that then we can establish a really peaceful society. And this, I'm sure now the world will do this. And I will just end my talk. I thank you for the attention. Thank you so much. Yeah, if Bande want to say, if you want to add something, please.
Kesa Buddha, this Kalama Sutta is a very modern day, the thinking, speaking, and questioning the freedom. And freedom of the religious, freedom of the other political thing, anything. And actually Europe and most of the United States, the freedom is very meaningful and living our South Asian area, hard to find the freedom. Ms. Dr. Bhandari know what exactly going on. And the freedom is not really, even though this century, and we have the thinking, freedom of the thinking, and our media freedom, all kind of thing is covered and posing by rules and government. But living here, we are so glad living in the United States. So far, we have a lot of freedom. So that's the best guideline for the freedom of the speak and freedom of the think. And the Kalam Sutta is very important to study and digest it. Very helpful. Thank you.